Hello viewer, this is the Science Hub, where you get to watch and learn. On today's lesson, we are going to focus on the domains theory. On our last discussion, we got to learn more about the magnets. We learned about the types of magnets, the magnetic field patterns, and all sorts of magnets. So, in today's discussion, we're going to continue the syllabus on magnetism, where we're going to learn about the domain theory, which my colleague Darrell is going to expound more on that.
And before we go to the domain theory, we have what is known as magnetic shielding. Magnetic shielding, this is protecting the magnet from stray magnetic fields, and it's done by use of keepers. The keepers. We have two, and they are placed on both the ends of the magnet. And when the keepers are attached towards the end of both magnets, the keepers acquire opposite poles compared to that of the magnet, therefore attracting the magnet and protecting it from stray magnetic fields by making the magnet concentrate within a loop. And as John Kita is going to expand more.
Yeah. So we are going to explain our domain theory, where it states that a magnet consists of subatomic magnets, which are known as dipoles. And these dipoles are arranged in small groups, which are known as domains.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
To demonstrate the domain theory, which I'll further emphasize that it's a theory that states that magnets are made up of subatomic particles known as dipoles. And the dipoles are arranged in small groups known as domains. This shall be demonstrated by use of the domain theory chart, which is made up of different types of materials that are magnetized. In domain theory, we have the unmagnetized material. Using the domain theory, we can state that in an unmagnetized material, the dipoles face in different directions, and so because the dipoles are not aligned in a similar direction, it means that they'll become magnetized. In the magnetized material, we'll find that the dipoles are aligned along the same direction but not parallel to each other. This means that the material will be magnetized because the dipoles are facing in a common direction. In the magnetically saturated material, we'll find that the dipoles are aligned facing the same direction that are parallel, unlike the magnetized material. They are parallel to each other. They are parallel to each other, making the material to be saturated. Therefore, further magnetization cannot take place.
So to expand on that, he has said that in a unmagnetized material, the dipoles are in a closed loop, meaning that their magnetic force is only circulating around the magnet. Yeah.
The demonstration.
Yeah. Meaning that the dipoles, which are consist the magnet, are in a closed loop, which means the force of the magnet is only circulating or concentrated within the magnetic band.
Yes.
And also to add on that, let me expand on the saturation. When a material is said to be saturated, it means that all the dipoles are aligned to a specific direction and they are also parallel to each other.
Yes.
And also another meaning of magnetically saturated material is that no more magnetization can take place.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in today's discussion, we shall also get to know more of ways of making a magnet. We shall get ways of creating magnets. We shall learn how to do them practically. So we have different various methods of creating magnets, which my friends, my colleagues, shall tell us more about them.
So just to state, we have the stroking method, the induction method, the hammering method, heating method, and the electrical method. And I think we are going to do them practically, some of them.
Okay, we'll start with the induction, which my colleague John Kita is going to demonstrate to us how we can we can create a magnet by induction.
So in induction, to induce, it means to bring or make the other object which you want to magnetize to acquire opposite pole to that of the material that you are using to magnetize. So in this case, we are going to use pins which are ionic. So in this case, we are going to attach our pin in the north pole of our magnet bar, and then we add another pin. We also attach another pin to our first pin, whereby it is also going to be attracted. What does this mean? It means, since the pole which we are using of the magnet is north pole, so the end of the pin which has been attached to the pole, the north pole is going to acquire an opposite charge to that of the north pole. So our pin here is going to acquire a south pole, hence the other end of the pin is going to acquire a south pole. That's why when we bring another pin and we attach it to the end of the first pin, the pin is going to be attracted, meaning that the end of the first pin is a south pole, which is an opposite polarity to the polarity used in the first in the magnetizing material. So the other pin will be induced with a north a polarity which is north.
Yes.
Then it will be attracted. Yeah.
To emphasize on what my colleague John Peter said, here is the way of magnetization by induction, which he has just demonstrated. We have found that the north pole, we have the north pole and the pins which are being magnetized. The pin, when brought close to the magnet, acquires an opposite polarity to the pole of the magnet. So that means that if the magnet has, we have brought a north pole of the magnet close to the pins will tend to acquire a south pole. But towards the end of the pins, they'll tend to acquire a similar polarity. So it means that when you bring another pin, it will acquire an opposite polarity to the end of the pin. So if this is the north pole, if it's the south, then the pin will tend to get the north pole. Well, Dara, can you get something to explain or expand more on that?
Yes, and also to expand, we also have the same. To show that this pin is magnetized, we can remove it. And you see that the pin is still attracting the other one. It means that the pin has received induced magnetism, and after some time it's going to fall. That means that we also have different materials depending on the rate of magnetization they get. For example, we have the soft magnetic materials, which they receive the magnetic, they get magnetized easily, but does not retain it for a long time. For example, the soft iron that you have used. And you also have the hard magnetic materials, which take too long to be magnetized, but retain the magnetism for a long period of time.
Yeah. So before we go any further, you might be wondering why the pin. You might be wondering why the pin after a short while is going to fall. So the reason which makes the pin after a short while, after you have detached the first pin from the magnetizing material, after a short while the pin will find that it's going to fall down. And you might be wondering why it is going to fall down. This is because the magnetism which the pin has acquired is temporary. So after a short while it is going to lose its magnetism. That's leading to the second pin to fall down.
Yes, my viewer, we have just talked about or discussed about the magnetization by induction. We shall also get to know more about magnetization by stroking, which is another way of creating magnets. Magnetization by stroking can be demonstrated in various ways. There are two types of stroking, the single stroke and the double stroke, which my colleague Daryl will get to explain.
In the single stroke, we are told that if my magnetizing material is this one, then I roll this magnet above it. The end of the material I'm going to magnetize receives opposite polarity compared to the end of the bar I used. Like practically,
if you observe that this end of this object will tend to acquire an opposite polarity to that of the pole used to magnetize the pin by the magnet.
And to know whether our material has been magnetized, we test it using iron pins or the office pins. Yeah. So as our colleague continues with the experiment, we have said that our second method of magnetizing is by stroking, whereby we have said that we have two types of stroking, which one of them is
a single
stroking and a double stroking, whereby in single stroking we use only one magnetizing material, and in double stroking we use two bar magnets to magnetize our material.
Just as I have done the single stroking, I rolled this magnet above this material, and when I rolled it, the material acquired a magnetic force that it was able to attract the office pins. So John Kita is going to lead us through the double stroking method.
So double stroking, as we have said, double stroking, we use two bar magnets. So in our magnetizing material, which must be a magnetic material, we are going to use two bar magnets, as I'm going to carry on. Remember, to stroke it means that your bar magnets are going to touch the material that you are magnetizing. So you stroke your material which you want to magnetize several times. And remember that we have said that the pole, the end of the material that you are magnetizing, where the pole was.
It receives the opposite polarity.
It receives the opposite polarity of the bar magnet that you have used.
And so the object tends to attract these office pins. Straight side. Oh, okay. You get to see that the object tends to attract the pins, the office pins. This object has been magnetized by stroking method. We have demonstrated using the single stroking method and also the double stroking method. We also have another way of creating magnets known as hammering. Hammering involves taking an object and placing it in the north-south direction. You hit or hammer the upper side of the object and you'll get to find that the object tends to be magnetized. This is because as you hit the object, it tends to disturb the dipoles.
Yeah.
And thus they become aligned in the same direction. Yeah. And that makes it magnetized.
As a point of emphasis, while magnetizing, you should magnetize in the north-south direction.
Yeah.
When you are magnetizing, you should magnetize in the north-south direction, because that is where the Earth's magnetic field is concentrated. Such that when you magnetize in the north-south direction, all the dipoles will be aligned to a particular direction, and the magnetic material will become magnetized.
What do you have to say about hammering, my colleague John?
So to add on that is only to emphasize the time when you'll be hammering your object which you are magnetizing. Remember, my colleague has said that you hold your material which you want to magnetize in a north-south direction of the Earth magnetic field. Yeah. So then you take in your hammer, you hit or you hammer at the upper part of the material that you are magnetizing several times. And by doing this, you'll be disturbing the dipoles, whereby after several hammering, the dipoles will get to be aligned. Yeah. At the same direction, therefore the material acquiring polarities, different polarities at the different end.
Going back to the stroking method, we left something. Why do we double stroke? Because if we single stroke, the distance between the North Pole and the South Pole, the distance between the South Pole and the North Pole becomes shorter. So that we can have a magnetized material with the North Pole and the South Pole far apart with double stroke.
So I can also add an advantage to the double stroking method, that in double stroking you can be able to create two magnets out of one object.
Yeah.
You can be able to create two magnets at the same time. So finally we shall get to learn more about the magnetization by electric method.
Yeah.
Which my colleague John Kita is going to demonstrate to us how we can do it.
In the electrical method of magnetizing our materials, so here I have my power supply, which is a direct current. So in magnetizing, we use direct current, whereby this is the connecting wires. These are the crocodile clips. So in this case, the red wires represent the positive terminal of the power, whereby the direction, so meaning that the direction of the current is flowing from the red wires through our solenoid. So at this part we have our material which we want to magnetize. This brown part, the brown part which you are seeing is the solenoid. And what is a solenoid?
Okay, a solenoid is a coil carrying current. And in this experiment, we use a solenoid to demonstrate how the electric currents magnetize the material.
Yeah.
And also to add, for you to have a better magnetized material, you need the coils need to be many.
Yeah.
You should use several coils, several turns,
yeah.
And you should also use shorter magnetism, the material to be magnetized.
Yeah. So to add on that, we have said that a solenoid is a coil with many turns copper wire which has been insulated, as the one we have right here. This is our solenoid. Inside the solenoid, we have a material which we want to magnetize, which is a soft iron rod. So, and we have got our switch. So on closing the switch, our current will flow from the positive terminal, which is represented by our red wires, will flow through the solenoid, then back to the negative terminal. And remember, the moment you pass your current through the solenoid becomes magnetized. So in this case, after closing the switch, our material which we are magnetizing acquires magnetism. And to get to know whether our material has been magnetized, we can use our ionic pins. So in this case, as you can see, our soft iron rod has been magnetized when it attracts the pin. Yeah.
And also to add, as you said earlier, that the material we are using here is a soft magnetic material. It means that when the switch is opened, therefore, the material will lose its magnetism. Yeah,
within a short time.
Within a short time.
Yeah. And then the pins will fall.
Yes.
Yeah.
As my colleague John Kita has demonstrated, this is a way of creating magnets by use of electric method. He has said that we use the electric current in order to magnetize the core. We magnetize the core which in turn attracts other magnetic materials such as the office pin. We shall also get to learn ways of demagnetizing a magnet.
Yeah.
There are several ways of demagnetizing a magnet. Yeah, my friend, my colleague here shall talk about them.
But before we go to demagnetization, just a point of emphasis. Remember that when using all these methods, when magnetizing, place your object in the north-south direction. So as we are going to demagnetization, you should place the material to be magnetized, which is a must, should be magnetic material, place it in the east-west direction. And the same methods that you use during magnetization is the same methods you are going to use during demagnetization.
Yeah.
But what matters is just a change of direction. Like if we stroked in the north-south direction to magnetize, we are now going to stroke in the south, no, in the east-west direction to demagnetize.
Yeah, and also when hammering, when you are demagnetizing your material, you will place your material which you are magnetizing into west, east west direction, and then you hammer it or you hit it. Yeah, and in this case, the dipoles will get to be disturbed, thereby they will be disoriented. Yeah, therefore losing the magnetism.
Yes.
So as my colleagues have said, ways of demagnetizing a magnet are just similar to the ways of magnetizing them. The difference is that the direction in which you are demagnetizing, it should face the east-west direction. And so...
And also, when demagnetizing a magnet, a magnetic material that was magnetized using the electrical method, now we are going to use the alternative current method. Which we shall talk about
later. And that's the end of our discussion. This is your favorite program, The Science Hub, on Elimu TV, where you get to watch and learn.
Thank you.